Okay, so welcome to this tutorial. I'm Marco Maratea from the University of Genova, Italy, and the DBRIS department. And it is a pleasure to be here virtually in Vienna to present this tutorial. And I thank the organizer, Dan and Mauro, for giving me this opportunity. And so I start my tutorial, which is about assisted programming, and is divided naturally into three parts. The first part is about the language, the second is about the solving approaches, and the last one is about applications. So our starting point will be Datalog, which is a well-known query language for database. So during the time I served as theoretical foundation to database and also logic programming. So, but at some point in the past, it was overcome in some way by other language, but like SQL. But in the last period, there has been a renewed interest in Datalog. For example, a series of workshops has been organized, and this interest is either in academia or in industry with some application, but also with some commercial systems based on it. As we said, Datalog is the base language of SAP, and instead SAP, what is? It's a declarative programming language, which roots in non-monotonic reasoning and logic programming, whose semantics was given by Gelf and Lipschitz in 1991, as it's called answer set or seven-mode semantics. It is an expressive KR language with default negation, disjunction, aggregates, constraints, and can express problems up to the second level of the polynomial hierarchy. So it is a strictly monoexpressor than set or CSP. Okay, so let's really move to our first part about the language with syntax and semantics. So SPCore2 is the standard language of SP. And it is made of Datalog, as I said, default negation, disjunction, constraint, plus aggregates. And then at some point, also the programming methodology behind ISP will be presented. Okay, still a fast recap about Datalog, logical language for querying database, and its name comes from the combination between data and logic, and overcome some limits of other language, even well-known like relational algebra or SQL, for example. It allows for recursive definition, and it has some application, for example, in query answering. So a rule in Datalog is made by a head and a body. And so head and a body are formed by atoms. And the intuitive meaning of this rule is that if the atoms in the body are true, so there is a reason for hay to be true into the solution. So in some way here, the body is supporting hay to be then part of the solution. Particular rule are facts. That is a rule with an empty body, and that represent basically our inputs. And there will be at some point constraint that are rule with empty head instead. Variables are allowed in atoms arguments, but must occur in the body for safety reasons. Okay, so as we will see during this tutorial, so things will be much more practical, and so theory and other things will stay a bit behind and introduced only when necessary. And in particular, quite in high level way. For example, let's have a look on this very simple program, which say that if X is a male and X is a parent of Y, so X is a father. And this is our database. And our query is what are the fathers? And so the result, of course, is the Rob is the only father inside this database, because basically we have to substitute constant to variables such that the variables name matches. And if we put here Rob and N, Here, Rob, of course, we can derive father of Rob. And it is the only additional information we can add from here. Let's consider another example. We have a graph encoded via the Hatton's hedge. And if you want to find all pairs of reachable nodes, of course, we cannot do this by using relational algebra or SQL. So we can go to Datalog. And so as you see, the definition is quite simple, but incurs some recursion. For example, if there is an edge from X to Y, then X is reachable from Y. But if X is reachable from Z, and Z is directly reachable via an edge to Y, so also X is reachable from Y. So you see here there is this recursive definition, which is something that is not allowed in SQL, at least in the very first version, and in relational algebra. So we cannot write an encoding a program using that language. So the intuitive meaning is quite simple. So we start from the input database, and we try to derive things in the head until a fixed point is reached. And the solution is minimal, and it is unique. Datalog is really a declarative language, because basically here we can substitute hedges with reachable. We can switch Hatton's variable ordering inside Hatton, so we can change the order of rules and nothing changed basically. So up to now, of course, we have seen Datalog programs that are positive, but sometimes it is not enough. For example, consider the problem which we want to compute the airports that are not reachable from Genova. Okay, so it's difficult to write a program that solves this problem with basic Datalog, so we need some form of negation. And the negation in logic programming is default negation. And so the intuitive meaning is something like, if we do not have evidence that X holds, so we conclude Y. A first very simple example, if the grass is not wet, so it didn't rain. But let's go to this more interesting example. So consider that we have as fact the Hatton's reaches, where we have the two airports which reaches each other. And here we construct the set of airport reachable from Genova, and then the reply of our query is basically all the airport but the one reachable from Genova. So you see how it is simple to reply to this question. Okay, stratified program are particular Datalog program in which there is a sort of ordering inside the rule, such that the rule can be processed stratum by stratum and evaluated. As I said, we do not go into the detail of definition, theorems, and result, but so the presentation will be highly more practical. Disjunction, so up to now, so we have the possibility only for having one solution, but of course, sometimes or often we want to model several alternative scenarios that correspond to several solutions. In this case, we can use disjunctive information. And disjunction is syntactically written, so in this way or with the OR. A very simple example about a rule that expresses disjunctive information is this one. If P is parent of S, then P is either a mother or a father of S. Okay, at some point, in particular, we will switch to application, we will be using another construct of SP, which are called choice rule. This is basically a shortcut for having a disjunctive rule like this, where P first is a fresh new atom not appearing in the program. So for this first part and the second part, we will consider only the junction, but in the third part, given that these are ugly used in the for writing programs and application, we will resort to choice rule. What are constraints? Constraints are rule with empty head. So this means that the element in the body cannot stay together. In this case, for example, this very easy rule ensures that none of the parents, none is a parent of himself. In SAP, we also have arithmetic constraints and built-in. For example, we can compute the Fibonacci series. And for example, in this way, these are the two facts, and this is the only rule that compute progressively the next Fibonacci number starting from the previous one. Okay, now we recap a bit the semantics of ISP program, because we have introduced the negation and disjunction. Now a rule is formed by an head, where we have atom in disjunction, and then we have a positive part of the body, and there is the negative part of the body. As we have understood in the body, the literals are considered instead in conjunction. Fact, still a rule with the empty body, and the constraint, a rule with the empty head. And there are also, similar to before, of course, some restriction to atoms inside, to variable inside atoms to guarantee some sort of safety, in particular that we cannot invent any value from nowhere. The informal semantic is something like this: if the atom in the positive part of the body are true and the atoms in the negative part of the body are not true, so at least one among the atom in the head are true. At some point it will be clear that this at least one will become exactly one, because the SAP semantics entails a minimality with respect to subset minimality and subset inclusion. This is just a program made of datalog plus disjunction plus negation, in which we use two of the rules we have seen before. Okay, so this is something that we will consider most later, but we just give an idea on how we deal with variables. So up to now, we have seen basically non-ground programs in which there are variables, and the grounding is the process that transforms a non-ground program in the ground program by replacing variable by the constant in the program in all the possible compatible ways. For example, consider this rule, which X attend SP if either is curious or is interested. And we know that John attend SP and Mary attend SP. So the instantiation here, of course, produce a program with four rules, the two facts plus the two rules that are the instantiation of the first non-ground rule, where John is substituted to X and Mary is substituted to X. And these are the first and the second rule of the instantiation. Let's focus only on John. And now we ask, what are the solution, the answer set, the stable models of this program? The facts, of course, must be into the solution. And if this is into the solution, the body is true, and this body support one of the two atoms in the head to be into the solution. So the two scenarios, the two solutions are M1 or M2. But consider, for example, that now we introduce a further fact, which is that John hates SP. Okay, it is reasonable, that also a constraint that is added, that say that it's not possible that John is interested and hates SAP at the same time. So this means that how our scenario change. So basically, the two models must be extended with the further facts, because the initial knowledge and the fact will be always part of our solution. But for example, the first extended model, let's say, is not a more solution because it violates this constraint, because these two ground atoms appear together in solution in the solution, but this is not possible because this is a constraint. And again, just to understand very high level how is the formal semantics of the SAP, we start from a non-ground program, we instantiate, then we define the semantics for positive ground program, and if we have a negative program, we transform this negative program with the gas from Litchfield reduct to a positive program, and then we test for some stability condition. Okay, up to now, we have evaluated the data. We have seen data log, default negation, disjunction, integrity constraint. Now we move, for example, to weak constraints. Weak constraint express desiderata. They are quite similar to soft constraint in CSP. And the idea is that I want to set the body as false, but if it is not possible, I pay a price for it. The price I pay is specified in this way via a weight and possible priority. And so the optimization problem entailed by program with weak constraint minimize the sum of the weight of the violated constraint starting from the highest priority level and then moving to the second level priority and so on. So this is a multi-criteria, multi-level optimization. As usual, an example, consider another problem that we called exam scheduling, in which we want to assign course exam to 3-time slot, avoiding overlap of exam of courses with common students. Okay, the strict solution without optimization is something like this. A course X can be either assigned to slot S1 or S2 or S3. And it is not possible that we assign course X and Y to the same slot when there are common students. If this is not possible, we can move to an optimal solution, and so we transform the hard constraint in the soft constraint, also syntactically, and we write something like this. So basically, this means that the pay we price the price we pay for if we violate this constraint is proportional to the number of students that are common between X and Y. And here zero can be avoided because if we have only one level, we can stay only with the weight. Aggregates, they are a very, very powerful construct of ISP. These are similar to aggregates in SQL and express functions that are calculated over sets of elements. And syntactically, they look like this. But as I said, so few details. For example, consider this example that say that this atom, the whole atom, is true if the number of male employees is greater than 5 and does not exceed 10. So here is a bit more elaborated example that show aggregate usage. This is a team building encoding in the Gioia Tauro seaport. Okay, this is only part of the encoding, but is one of the examples that show quite clearly how aggregate can be used in order to have a very nice knowledge representation. Okay, there is a rule in which basically the team are formed, say that an employee can be in a team or out of the team. And then, for example, if you want to express that the team consists of a certain number of employees, we say that basically we had a constraint that say it is not possible that the number of employees in a team is different from them. Or, for example, if you want to express something like at least a given number of different skills must be present in the team, we had the constraints that say that the number, because we are using a count, the number of skills that are in the team cannot be less or equal than M, because we want this number of skills to be greater than M. Okay, and the same thing, we can reason about budget or specific limit, and we can use, of course, instead of count, also sum and max with the usual semantics. Okay, this is an outline of the main construct that are present in SAP. Now we move to describe a bit the methodology with some example that will contain most of these constructs. So what is the programming methodology? What is the idea of programming with SAP? So we model a domain, and particularly we single out input and output predicates. We route an SAP program modeling our input program into the problem. And the general idea is that we use predicates representing relevant entity. And then if we are not solving a combinatorial problem, so we can do a direct encoding with possibly stratified data log. Otherwise, if you are dealing with an hard combinatorial problem, so the methodology that we want to use is the guess, check, and optimize methodology of SAP. And basically, guess solution using the disjunctive rules or choice rule. In the checking part, we cut the solution that are not admissible, and we cut the solution using strong constraint. If we have an optimization problem, we specify preferences. In other words, disjunctive rules generate candidate solutions, constraint, test solution, discarded unwanted ones, and we constrain the single out optimal solution from the one that are only satisfiable, let's say. Okay, let's move now to, as I said, to a number of examples. First example, group assignments. We want to partition a set of persons into two groups, avoiding that father and children belong to the same group. Okay, the input is represented by a unary atom person and a binary atom father. We have a disjunctive rule that guesses possible assignment. A person P is assigned to either group one or two. And then a constraint that this discard unwanted solution. Basically, it say if P1 is father of P2, then P1 and P2 cannot stay into the same group. And to give an idea how it does work, for example, consider the first rule, the guessing part, and we make an hypothesis that these are the three facts, the three input. So by instantiating these rules with the constant inside this fact, In a compatible way, we obtain these four possible solutions. Then we add the constraint. And for example, out of the two possible solutions, of only two are still solution because for example, we have eliminated the first one because we have that John is the father of Joe, but they are together in group one. And we eliminated the fourth solution, the fourth candidate solution, because the same old for group two. So going a bit more into the details of solving that we will say later in the second part of the tutorial, the guessing part defines the search space and the check part specify what are the undesired solution or the desired one, of course. Second example, the well-known tree colorability problem. Consider that in input we have a unary atom node and a binary atom hedge. A node X can be either colored red, yellow, or green. And it is not possible that if there is an edge from X to Y, X and Y are colored in the same way. As I anticipated, now it is quite clear that given that Datalog and SAP programs entails minimality, so solution are subset minimal, here basically only one color per node is assigned and taken from the first rule, even if in principle all these three can be true. Third example, Hamiltonian path. So find a path in a graph beginning at the starting node, which contains all nodes of graph. The input is made of two binary atoms, node and start, and one binary atoms edge. Okay, the guessing part, if we have an edge between X and Y, then so XY is either in the path or out of the path. These two rules specify that a node can be reached only once. And assuming that we have constructed a unary atom reached that we will define later, of course, we want that all nodes must be reached, and we say that it is not possible that node X is not reached by a constraint. And we specify that the path is not cyclic. This means that if there is an edge between X and Y, it is not possible that Y was the starting node. Otherwise, we are reaching again the starting node. It is something that we don't want given the definition of the problem. Of course, again, first rule, guessing part, all the constraint checking part that eliminate unwanted solution. And then in this case, we have also some auxiliary rules in order to construct reachability, the reached atom. And okay, this is quite simple. X is reached if it is the starting node, or is reached if Y is reached and the edge YX is part of the path we are building. Consider now the traveling salesman problem, Carson problem, another well-known problem, which is basically Hamiltonian path plus minimal length. So we update edge having a third variable, which is the distance between X and Y, or the weight of this node. So basically we have the very same program, but we have to add optimization, and basically the optimization here state something like this. So remember that optimization say that we want to minimize the sum of the weight of violated constraint. In this case, so the trick somehow is that this is, how to say, surely, if you are considering the path we are building, this is surely unsatisfied, because impact is constructed using hedges. So basically, here we are saying that the optimization is such that the pay we price, the price we pay if we are considered the edge XY, which is in the path we are building, is of course C. And how this means that out of all the possible paths that we could build in order to satisfy the problem, here we consider the one that minimizes the sum of the length defined out of each edge. So I'm done with the first part. Last consideration, I want to thank Francesco Ricca, my friend, first of all, and then calling from the University of Calabria for providing a preliminary version of this slide. And so we will see later for the second part about the main solving SAP approaches. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, so we move now to the second part of my tutorial about ancestor programming. I again want to thank Mauro and Dan for the invitation. So some assumptions. So now we are going to see some of the main approaches for solving SCP programs, then we will assume that the program was not already in propositional form, so grounding or ready to praise. And so we are going to present the algorithm using the abstract solver methodology. So, okay, usually, so just a few words about this methodology. Usually, solving procedure for solver are presented by means of pseudocode descriptions or natural language processing, but some community has experienced that could be more fruitful to use performance, for example, based on mathematically precise object for having, for example, a uniform representation that the other two, the previous methods do not guarantee. Okay, research-oriented, there was already a topic. What is it? The topic for the tutorial in 2015 at SLP by myself. And so the paper that won the last SLP 2019 paper award, best paper award, employed abstract solvers. So first, what are these abstract solvers? Are a methodology for describing, comparing, and composing solving procedure via graphs, where the state of computation are the nodes, the solving techniques are the hedge, and the solving process is a path in the graph, and the formal properties of the algorithms are reduced to related graphs properties, so it will be very easy to state and prove this property. As I said, they are good for describing solving procedure in an abstract way, for comparing solver by means that of comparing related graph, and combining the abstract solution in order to define new solving methods, while they are not that good, of course, for specifying low-level implementation details and for arguing about the efficiency of implementation built on this basis, because, of course, this may depend on, for example, data structure and efficiency of the implementation. We will start by describing the abstract solver for DPLL, which will be the basis then for some of the solving procedure for SP we are going to present. Okay, given a set of atoms, a record relative to this set of atoms is a string L composed of literals over X or the symbol bundle with no repetition, and some literals may be annotated with this delta, and these are called decision literals. So these records are just a convenient way to represent assignments in a compact way. We say that the record is inconsistent, similarly to assignment, when it contains both a literal and its negation, or it contains bottom. Otherwise, it is consistent. Now, as I said, we want to define the abstract solver, the graph describing high level DPLL. So we need to define its node, and we need to define its edges. And we define that the state relative to a set of atoms, X in this case, is either a record relative to X or to particular state called sat and unsat. The node in particular of the graph DPLL OF are the set of nodes that consists of state relative to the signature of the formula F we want to define. And we say that a node is terminal if no hedge is there from it. And the state empty set is called initial, and this corresponds to an assignment in which we have not yet assigned any variable. And so these are the transition rules that justify hedges in the graph DPLL of F. We have a starting state, and starting from the state, if we apply this rule, we reach this other state, and these are the conditions under which we could apply a rule. So basically, if we are in an inconsistent state, and we have no decision literal in our state, so we can say that we can go to the Assad state. Instead, if we are in an inconsistent state and L was the last decision that was made, so we can go to the new state in which basically we go back and revert the value of L. We can add L to our record, to our assignment, if there is a clause in which basically there are all the literal but L assigned already in the wrong way about our assignments. Decide we are in a consistent state and still an atom or a literal integration are not assigned, so we are free to assign this atom, this literal by decision. And then if no other rule applies, this means that we can move to the sub state. Okay, you can see how it is easy to state, for example, correctness and completeness of the algorithm together with some other property. So we can say that the graph DPLL is finite and acyclic. Any time in a state reachable from initial state other than unsat is sat, and unsat is reachable from the initial state if and only if f is unsatisfiable. For example, here we see an example. Okay, these are two possible paths inside DPLL graph, starting from the initial to a final state. For example, for the formula A or B and not A or C, we start from the empty set. We add A by decision, then by unit propagate on the second clause. And here we can apply unit propagation because of this condition are met. We can add C. Then the only rule that we could apply is the site. We add, for example, B by decision. And here, no other rules apply. So we apply this assess and the state that's the formula is satisfiable. And in the state preceding the last one, we got also the satisfied assignment. This means that A to true, C to true, and B to true. This is another possible path to the solution, and the difference is that this path is a path that indeed will be followed by any solver. By this is a path in the graph, but in practice will not be followed by any solver, because, for example, in the second rule application, here we applied the side where unit was applicable. Okay, basically we'll see that a real implementation, a real algorithm will correspond to a graph, plus some ordering in rules application. For example, here in such order, this is the ordering followed by the solver. So if you want to improve this algorithm with back jumping and learning to go to CDCL, basically we have to do some update. An update is basically that now a state called the standard is made by a record and a set of clauses that can be learned. The initial state is as empty assignment and no added clause. We have to do some update and extension. For example, in conclude and decide, we update the state. In unit learn, other than updating the state, we could also add the unit either from the initial formula we want to decide the satisfiability, and then also from the added clauses. And then backjump, now we are not forced to backjump to the last decision literal, but depending on the particular learning and backjump we do, we could jump back to a literal that satisfies this condition. And stating learn is very easy. We can add C to the set of learned clause if C is entailed by the formula and every atom in C occurs in F. The first condition is added because we do not want to add new variables, otherwise so we would change, let's say, at runtime the state of the formula. And this is something that the state of the graph, this is something that we don't want to do. And also success is changed by saying something like, if no other rules apply, other than learn. This is because even when we can state the format to be satisfiable, for example, in this case, so we could learn and add new clauses, but that they do not change the satisfiability of the problem, of course. And when it comes for back jumping and learning comes into play, usually other two techniques are implemented, then here they are modeled using in a very easy and modular way. Modular in the sense that can be added modularly to the other rules. Restart, we can restart the search from scratch at some point, keeping the already added clauses, and forget, we can forget a clause in order to guarantee, for example, that the algorithm works in polynomial space. This is an example. Slide modification, instead of having only one, let's say, sat state, now we have a family of okay state. And the idea is that by having this okay, we have in the very last state the assignment, the record that brought the formula to be satisfied. Okay, so now we move to SP. We start from non-disjunctive SP program. This is something we already seen. So now consider a very first modification of DPLL graph. So consider a graph GT. I consider that we have F, which is a CNF formula, and G is a generic formula formed from atoms in F. Graph GT, that takes F and G, as the nodes are the same as DPLL, and the edges are justified by the transition rule of DPLL plus this testing rule. And this testing rule, basically, if we are in a consistent state, and our formula G entails the negation of the literals that are in the assignment that constitute a clause, so we can add G in the way to forcing a backtracking. So the goal of test is forcing a backtracking, and in a few minutes we will see why this is the case. Okay, basically this is still the formal result about correctness and completeness of GT with respect to finding a model of G and F. So one side note about abstract solver, at the beginning of this part, we mentioned that these abstract solvers are good to compare abstract procedure by comparing the related graph. And we can easily see that the graph DPLL of F is a subgraph of the graph GT. Okay, SAT solver, CMODELS, SAP solver, CMODELS, translate the formula in SAT, compute an assignment, and then check whether this assignment is indeed an answer set. And so GT describe CMODELS with backtracking by instantiate F with the completion of pi and G with a set of the loop formula. And apply test only on model of F in order to check whether, as I said, the model of a completion is also a solution of the program. If OKL is reached, the positive literal in the record are the answer set of pi. An example, we have this very easy program. The completion is A or not A, and the set of formula, we have only one formula, which is not A. I will not go into the details, but basically loop formula takes into account the loop that are in the program. Because here is the loop, this means that A cannot support itself to be into the solution, so we should avoid these things. And for each loop, we have a loop for. Okay, now, for example, let's see how the search proceeds in this way. We start from the empty set. We add A for decision. Now we can apply test because the negation, because G entails the negation of A. So this means that basically A is a model of the completion, but is not an answer set of the original program. So we add not A, we backtrack not A. Now no more clause, no more rule can be called other than success, and we go in a state okay of not A. The set of positive atoms, positive literals in not A is the empty set, but this is because the empty set is the only answer set of pi. And we can extend GT with like jumping and learning by doing a similar extension on how DPLL is extended to form CDCL. These are only the update to backjump GT, learn GT, and test GT, where basically we have updated the state with the extended state. And here for GT with learning, that we call GTL. Okay, so here there is an L missed. This is correctness and completeness of GT of L with respect to finding a model of F and G, but note that for GTL, here we can only say that it's finite. We may lose a cyclicity because nothing prevents to add and forget the same rule. Now, okay, how C models is described by GTL? Basically, we have the same instantiation as before, and we can describe C models with learning using GTL plus some constraint, plus some rule application. For example, we apply GT in a state reached by the application of backjump GT, and test is applied only on models of F union gamma, and backjump GT is first applied on a state reached by the application of test. And basically, so these three algorithm flow, which are implemented within C models, are guaranteed by these rules ordering. We can use also GTL in order to describe abstract CLASP by using the same rule as GTL plus a rule called unfounded. What is an unfounded set? An unfounded set is a set of atoms that will never be part of the solution. So atom by atom, we can add the negation of A, which is an atom into the funded set to our record. Then we use a particular reordering that guarantee some algorithm flow, which is indeed implemented in CLASP. And similarly, we could also describe the WASP. Okay, this was for the main set-based solving family. Then let's move to some solver that do not rely on SAT encoding, but they directly deal with the program. We start by this at least. At least is able to compute supported models of program pi. Still no answer set, but supported model. At least graph instantiate with the program pi. has node that are state relative to the set of atoms pi, and the edges are justified by the transition rule decide, conclude, backtrack, and success of DPLL, and some additional rule for describing deterministic consequences. So basically, in DPLL, we have only unit in order to do deterministic consequences, simplification, but here, given the richness of SAP, we can simplify with more room. For example, unit propagate LP, we can add A to our assignment if there is a rule that supports A to be in the solution. We can add not A if for every rule that may support A to media solution, the body is actually false with respect to the actual assignments, backchain true. If there is a rule in which A is already assigned as true, and for each other rule that may support A to be into the solution, but its body is contradicted by the code assignment, so this means that this is the rule that may support A to be in a solution, so we have to assign the levels in the body to true in order to have these rules supporting from A. And then backchain false, if we have a rule of this form such that not A is assigned or A is false, and all the other literals in the body are assigned in the correct way. So to make A false, we could also make L false. Still, correctness and completeness of at least with respect to computing supported models of Pi. Another interesting result is that for any program Pi, the graph at least and the PLL on the completion of Pi, in this case, we are considering the completion that does not add any variable, are equal. So they coincide. They are exactly the same graph. Let's see an example of at least. We have this program. We start from the empty set. We add A by decision. Then we add C from the third rule by unit. Then we can add not B because the only rule that could support B to be in the solution is such that at the moment the body is unsatisfied. And then by decision we add D. And by success we reach OK of this state. This means that the assignment A to true, C to true, B false and D true is a supported model of the program. But now we want to compute our set. So we start by at least, and basically we add the unfounded rule we have seen before for CLASP. And we reach the SM graph that will be the abstraction of the well-known S-model solver, which was one of the first solver that dealt with the SP semantics. Okay, here it is still correctness and completeness of the SM graph with respect to being able of computer this time associated to Pi. And let's consider the example that we did before. So if we were on at least, if you remember, now we can conclude. But now we have this, that given the last rule, the set D is an unfounded set. So if you remember, we could add not D. So we apply unfounded, we add not D. So we backtrack to not D. Now no other rule apply. We reach a final state, and here the final state say that AC is the answer set of the program, as expected. And then how the real S models is described via SM. So as usual, the graph SM of pi plus a given rules ordering. For example, if you see here is a path that S models would really follow. While this is a path that is possible in SM graph, but given this ordering will not be followed by S models implementation. And similarly, as we did from GT to GTL, we can also move from graph SM to SML by adding bench jumping and learning and doing similar modification in order to describe ISP solver S-model CC, which is S-models plus bench jumping and learning. One other thing that we said in the beginning is that this abstract solver should be good also for combining techniques from different solvers for having new abstract solution. And the SUP is a solver that does exactly this. And then it was implemented and led to positive result by participating in the third ISP competition and to comparing quite well with the other. Okay, up to now, we have seen disjunctive, non-disjunctive progress. Now we move a bit more briefly to disjunctive SAP program and how we can model disjunctive problem in SAP. So we take advantage of the common architecture of disjunctive answer set solver because they are composed on a generate that we will call left part or layer and a test layer or right layer or part. The generate layer is used to obtain a set of candidates that are potentially answer set. The test layer is used to verify whether a candidate is indeed an answer set. So basically, our main idea should be having two graphs, one left graph and one right graph that work on programs which are NP or CoNP, and then they communicate each other with some additional rules. Of course, we have to change something. For example, the concept of state. The state now is a pair in which basically L will be the record, the assignment for the left part, and R will be the state or the assignment in the right part. And then there is also a label which say if you are working on the left side or if you are working on the right side. And the other things doesn't change. Okay. Yeah, so the syntax of the disjunctive progress, but this is something we already saw. There is, so this technical concept, I won't go into detail. The important thing is that this technical content describe, for example, what are the properties of the program or formula that we will give to the left part, and what are the properties of the formula or program that will be given to the right part in order to test the assignment on the left part. An important thing is that the witness function, so what we will give to the right part for checking, depends on the program, depend on the candidate solution that we are given from the left part, and formula and program usually are constructed such that L is an answer set if and only if the formula or program tested by the right part is unsatisfiable. Okay, now so we concentrate, we instantiate on C models, this concept, and then we will have a look as for some other graphs. So CMODELS is a solver which has the generator and test layers made of SAT. So we will have two DPLL graphs running concurrently and then exchange information in a way that you are going to see. So the graph we call DPLL2, G and T are the particular formula for instantiated the SAT formula that will be given to the left side and to the right side. The nodes consist of states related to the sets, the atom in G of I, and the union of the atoms that are given to the right part. This is a formula that is given to the left part. And the edges are described by modify and additional transition rule. Okay, the initial state is something like this. Of course, at the beginning, the assignment of the left part is empty, the assignment on the right part is empty, and we are working on the left part. So these are the left rule. As you see, these are exactly the rules for DPLL, where the state are updated, where we consider G of I, and success is missing. And now we will see why success is missing. Right rules, we have L because came from the left part, and we are working on modify R, of course. And now the formula that is considered is the formula T. So as we said, if the formula given to the right part is unsatisfiable, L was in the natural set. This is how T is usually defined in this solver. And then so here we miss success, and now we see where success is. Okay, so we have these two graphs, which are two instances of DPLL, and then they have to communicate each other, as I said, in some way. Okay, basically this is the success rule of the left part, that now we call cross LR, because basically if no other rule apply, this means that L is a solution on the left part, and we have basically only to give the control to the right part, and now we will start working on R. Instead, the opposite crossing rule RL, when we found a solution for the formula given in the right part, as this constructed, this means that that L was not an answer set. So we have to go back looking for other candidate. But if L contain no decision literal, we can define pi to be unsatisfiable or incoherent, so no set for pi. Or otherwise, we force a backtracking in the left part, we continue search in the left part for other assignments. Okay, this is just a compression of the theoretical result we have seen by now that we have used in some paper. So we call all the condition basically check. And abstract CMODELS is described by DPL2 by instantiating G with the completion and T with the formula that intuitively tests minimality of the modes of completion. And this is, in a compact way, correctness and completeness of DPL2 with respect to the stable models. Instead, in GMT, we have two instances of S-models running concurrently. So we have two graph SM, and then the crossing rules. And the crossing rules are the same of DPLL2. The formula are defined in this paper, and basically formula G translate a non-disjunctive program, to a non-disjunctive program by guaranteeing that what the non-disjunctive program to produce is a supported model. Then has to be checked by a formula T of G. And here we call the abstract solver of solver GNT, SM2, and this is the theoretical result that guarantees that it can check the stable model of pi. Skip the example, DLV, another very famous SP solver. So, DLV uses a modification of the SM graph for the left part plus DPLL for the right part. And the modification of the left part is that DLV is able to directly deal with disjunctive rules. Of course, DLV need a test, but is able to work on disjunctive rule on the left side. This means that function GD is the identity function, and then TD defined in this paper is again for checking minimality. And this is the correctness and completeness result for DLV. Of course, as we said at the beginning, a second example, a property of this abstract solver is that they are good and should be more easy to invent new algorithms. For example, it's quite clear that we can easily define a new abstract solution which has DPLL on the left and SM on the right that is not implemented yet in any solver. Who knows if it is better or not. Very recent work on these things. With some colleague, we had defined a general abstract template for the two layers disjunctive architecture, such that properly instantiated produces specific models GNT and DLV behaviors in this paper. And then very recently, a student of mine that graduated 2 weeks before in mathematics at UVN extended the framework to include backchamping and learning either in the single solver and in the template. So up to now we have considered brave reasoning, but quite briefly, as cautious reasoning is quite important in SP. In cautious reasoning, solution must be witnessed by whole answer set, and cautious reasoning as a number of applications. So what is the state of the art, and what are the more recent results? There are some SP solver, in particular CLASP DLV, that has been extended to compute cautious consequences by relying on call to basic SAP Oracle for brave reasoning. There has been a paper that has presented and implemented and tested in WASP several algorithms employing these and other techniques. Then with my former postdoc student, we took the algorithm here and we proposed this algorithm. We presented this algorithm by means of abstract solver. Then 2 years ago, further algorithms for cautious reasoning in SAP were defined in this paper by taking techniques from backbone computation of SAT, which is a problem which is highly related to cautious reasoning SAP, And then, so last year, so we took the techniques newly defined here. We presented these techniques via Abstract Solver. We define new algorithms, we implemented these algorithms, and we show that we can have very good results with respect to the state-of-the-art benchmark and tool. And we also state precisely the correspondence between the BECSMO computation in SAT and conscious reasoning in SAP. And with some of my colleagues at the University of Calabria, we won the ICLP 2019 Best Paper Award. So this is all for the second part of my tutorial. And then the third and last part of the tutorial will be devoted to SP applications. So I'll see you soon. Thank you. Okay, so welcome to the third part of my tutorial, which is about SAP in particular. In this third part, we will speak about SAP application. Okay, we will first give a few details about the number of applications, and then we will focus on scheduling applications in which SAP is, how to say, giving its best in the last period. So first of all, why we want to use SAP in application? Because we have seen that it has a rich syntax and intuitive semantics, so very readable from a customer, for example, which is something very important. And efficient solvers are available, for example, due to a number of competition events during these years, and there is also the availability of some useful programming environments like IDE and debugging tools. For example, so we have a variety, as I said, of application. For example, question answering for cultural heritage, where SAP combined with natural language processing techniques, and SAP in particular uses for matching the question patterns. There is team building in the GeoTauro support. Part of the encoding we have seen already in the first part as an example of using aggregates. And this is a program of team building of a subsidiary in the GeoTauro support. And then there are some more industrial applications like partners unit and combined configuration, which are problem, abstract problem by Siemens. Okay, of course, abstract, not in the sense that that gave you in the second part of my tutorial, but abstract in the sense that are abstraction or real problems dealt by Siemens. And so there, off the shelf ICP system were not enough. So authors had to design and implement custom heuristic domain dependent within WASP. Other applications are in the context of routing driverless transport vehicles in car assembly, where the problem is to set up routes in the context of car assembly in collaboration with Mercedes-Benz. And you can find some more applications in some recent surveys. The first one is about general overview of application, and the second one focus on industrial applications. Okay, moving instead to SP in scheduling application. So here we have a number of. First, this is the incremental scheduling problem. If the problem is to assign jobs to devices such that the execution do not overlap each other, then there are independent scheduling games, in which the problem is to deal with independent services among players that can control only the limited number of services and schedule in an independent way. The conference paper assignment problem, where of course the problem is to assign reviewer from the program committee to the papers that were submitted to the conference. And further focusing on the healthcare domains, we have, for example, the nurse scheduling problem, in which the problem is to create a schedule of nurses working in hospital units under some requirements. And our focus is on small, medium-sized Italian hospital, because is one of the hospitals we work with, and we have data from there. And then there is the operating room scheduling with bed management, where the problem is to assign patients to operating room, taking into account specification, like having different specialties, such duration and priority among patients. Then you have beds availability, and still here the focus is on small, medium-sized Italian hospital. So in particular, SAP in scheduling and in the healthcare domain has been recently recognized by the wide community of CLAIRE to be a good solution, to be a good tool for solving this problem, given that, for example, I have been appointed 2 months ago as a coordinator of the topic, scheduling and assessment management by the CLER COVID-19 task force. Okay, now we focus on these two problems and we see the encoding as some companion results. For example, in the NURBS, basically the input are, okay, our main NURBS is we have the days and the shift. A shift link, the shift with an ID and the number of hours for this shift. Then there are so three particular shifts, special rest, rest and vacation, of course with zero working hours, and we will clarify in the encoding what does they mean. Of course, the first rule is for defining the search space through a choice rule. We choose an assignment for each day and for each nurse. Then there are coverage constraints. These were constraint specification that were gave us by our customer. Coverage constraint in which we have to limit the nurses that must be present for each shift. For example, the number of nurses for a given shift in each day cannot exceed a maximum number. It cannot be less than a minimum one. Then there are workload constraints, which are similar, but with respect to minimum and maximum working hours per year. Okay, for each nurse, the number of hours the nurse work for the whole year cannot be greater than a maximum number and cannot be less than a minimum number. Then, so in the specification that we had, the nurses had exactly 30 days of vacation. Vacation was mapped to ID6. And here we say that the number of days in which a nurse is in vacation cannot be different from 30. Another constraint is each nurse cannot work twice in 24 hours. Yeah, so we play a bit with the day and the ID shift in order to design this constraint. And the same, we play a bit with this number in order to specify constraints in which we impose that at least two rest days for each 14 days must be given to each nurse. And this is the rest of type 5. Then, after two consecutive nights of working, there is a special rest day. For example, the first constraint says that it is not possible that for a nurse after having worked in the night at day minus two, and then day minus one, she's not in this special rest day. Then we have balance constraints that states that morning, afternoon, and night shifts assigned to every nurse should range over a set of acceptable values. Here we said, of course, that each nurse a day she works in a particular shift, and here we focus only on morning, night, and afternoon, cannot be greater than max and cannot be minimum than min. This is for the decision problem. If you want an optimization problem, we sort of switch the strong constraint into a weak constraint that say that which minimize the deviation with respect to a given a target, let's say, number of days in which a nurse works in the morning and afternoon and in the night. We have done some scalability analysis. Why this number? Because 41 was the number of nurses in the particular hospital we are collaborating with. So the scalability takes into account 10, 20, 41, 82, and 164. And of course, we proportionally scaled some numbers in order to be compliant with these other numbers. And here you see the scalability analysis using Klingo for such number of nurses. This is the execution time. And here you see that all key instances up to 160 for nurses, every instance was solved by Klingo within an hour. Okay, and here, so this is a particular result in the sense that optimization problem is looks faster than the decision one. And this is probably due to the fact that the constraint related to the optimization problem is very thin. So it's very highly help to look for a solution, to help the solver to individuate a solution because it's very focused, it's very thin. Then we have asked another paper in which we have an improved encoding of the new scheduling, for example, taking into account symmetry, which is this one. Of course, it has an encoding which is a bit less readable from the one I show you now. But on the other hand, the results are quite different. So the second encoding is more efficient, more than one order of magnitude. The second application is about operating route scheduling. So here we have more input to our problem. We have the Hatom registration, which represent registration characterized by an ID, a priority score, a surgery duration, a length of stay, a specialty, a length of stay in the HICU, and a number of days in advance a patient is admitted to the ward before the surgery. Then we have the HATOMS MSS, which is the master surgical schedule, which link operating rooms with a session to a specialty and in a planning day. We have OR session duration, represented by the duration HATOM. And then we have instances of the HATOM beds that represent the number of available beds in a day for a specialty. And the EQ is represented by having zero as a specialty, is considered as a particular specialty, let's say. Here is our encoding. First, we choose an assignment for the registration. Okay, here is the, with here we define the search space, we do the guess with the choice rule, ensuring that the MSS is satisfied. Then there are constraints that say that the number of registrations should not be assigned more than once in different OR or session. Other constraints that state that the total length of surgery duration assigned to a session is less than or equal to the session duration. Okay, here we satisfy this constraint by having an auxiliary rule. Auxiliary in the sense we have used in the first part of the tutorial that create a new HATOM surgery, and then a constraint that state that the sum of the surgery duration cannot exceed this the session duration. Then beds come into play, and so these three rules basically deals with the assignments of bed to patients, some days in advance, then in the ICU, and then for the whole length of stay. For example, the first deals with the issue of assigning a bed in the ward to which registration in an OR for the days before the surgery. Basically, here the bed is assigned from day D minus A to D minus one. Remember that A is a number of days in advance before the operation in which a patient needs a bed. The third one assigns a bed in the intensive care unit. So from the day D of the operation until day D plus EQ minus one. And the third one assigns the bed after the EQ from the entire length of stay, if after the EQ, as is likely, a patient need to stay in the ward for some more days. Then there are the last constraints that stay that verify the number of patients occupying a bed or in the ICU. Basically, the first state that it is not possible that the number of patients here registration, but these are the patients, is greater than the available beds. This is for the speciality, and this is done for the ICU, but these are the same. Then, so in this particular problem, so we had the specification in which patients were organized into three priority levels, depending, for example, of urgency of the operation. And the specification was that every registration for patients having priority one need to be assigned. Then we assign as much as possible of the others, giving precedence to registration having priority two over those having priority three. Basically, so this is done using one hard constraint and two soft constraints. So the first constraint basically say that given a target number of total registration of priority one, it is not possible that we do not assign every registration of priority one. While the two, we turn a very similar constraint into a weak constraint. And so the weight is the difference between our target and the priority two or three that are indeed assigned, giving precedence to priority two over priority three by having a level which is higher. So maybe I given put any details for this analysis because was a bit more involved than the previous one. But the interesting things, and you can have a look, on the paper if you want, is that basically here there are two constraints to the resource, which are the beds and the OR time usage. So basically the the encoding is able to optimize the resource which is more constrained, in the sense that if the bed are the in the presence of scarce bed resources, our encoding, as you can see from the result in the paper, can try to optimize the usage of such of the beds, which are very important, for example, in this crisis period, and probably also in the post-crisis, which we hope that will arrive soon. While if we have enough bed, the encoding automatically optimize the OR time utilization. Indeed, we have different scenario with different value from the beds, scenario in which we have an abundance of beds and a scarcity of bed, or even an extreme scarcity. So as I said, so the analysis is a bit more involved and large. So you are welcome to have a look. On basically this paper. So my tutorial ends here. Thank you for the attention. I will be happy to reply to any question. Of course, you find all the references I pointed out in my three parts at the end of my tutorial slides. And finally, I would still like to thank Mauro and Daniel for giving me this opportunity. And I hope you liked the tutorial and you can appreciate more ICP. Maybe some of you can think about contacting me or working together on some interesting stuff. Thank you again.